headline your idea that you've recently come up with of capturing, you know, what is going on with Wokeism,
and
what is a suitable theory to explain it, and your idea that it is inverted, a form of inverted fascism, is fascinating.
Okay. For some time, I've been mulling over the idea of wokeness, because I see a lot of people writing about it and on YouTube videos, and they're saying a lot of things that I agree with. But I thought this doesn't seem to be a proper overall theory here. And of course, there's no handbook of woke theory that explains what it is, and any more than there is a handbook on, you know, true fascism, and this is what true fascism is. So, and I was talking to a friend, or perhaps I ought to say an acquaintance, who calls himself a fascist. And I pointed out to him that, you know, there are parallels between fascism and wokeism. And he was extremely annoyed that I should say, he said, no, of course not, because wokeism is the exact opposite of fascism. I said, yeah, well, in a way it is, but not in its methods. So that's how I came up with the idea. And I ought to start with the analogy of snobbery and inverted snobbery. Because if we say that a snob is somebody who likes to look down upon and socially hold back people from what he or she judges to be a lower socioeconomic group, you know, that's a snob. He's not prepared to take people for their, you know, inherent virtues and abilities. He wants to say, no, you are beneath anything I will look at, because you're not from a lower socioeconomic group. That's a snob. And an inverted snob, which is an idea which is quite well known, is somebody who does the same fundamental thing that a snob does, which is look down on certain people and try to keep them down and out and disapprove of them. But he simply inverts the value. And so he puts the higher social economic groups at the bottom and the lower ones at the top. So he gives preference for people from lower socioeconomic groups, irrespective of their real abilities, and would hold back people, even if they have great ability, just because they have a public school or aristocratic background. And that's, we say, same method, but inverted values. What he values and disvalues have been switched. And we call him an inverted snob. So by analogy with that, I say that what woke does is it uses the methods of fascism, the state in bed with the corporations, in order to impose something which is at the very least authoritarian, but might more colloquially be called totalitarian rule on people. But that's the method. But then when we come to the values, all of the things that the fascist wants to protect and promote, the wokel or wokester or what have you wants to denigrate and destroy. So the fascist wants to protect the nation and the dominant or indigenous ethnicity, the culture, the history, and so forth. There is no, as I said, there's no book on this is what fascists believe, but you can sort of glean general picture from the sort of thing, and by talking to people who say they're fascists, and you say, do you believe in the, you say, oh yeah, that's what I believe in, yes. By contrast, to the extent that you're woke, you just want to destroy all these things, the nation, the indigenous ethnicity, the history, the family, sexuality as ordinarily conceived, everything that the fascist values. If you're woke, you disvalue it. And therefore, in the same sense, I say that an inverted snob is still a kind of snob. We know what that means. It's not nonsense to call an inverted snob a snob. An inverted fascist is still a kind of fascist. It's not nonsense. It makes the same sort of sense. However, even if you want to say, no, that's going too far, you can't say that they're any kind of a fascist, as long as they don't have the same values. I can say, well, however you want to label them, whether you accept inverted fascist or not, and then you'd have to explain why you might accept inverted snob, but you don't accept inverted fascist. They're far worse than fascists. They're far worse than fascists because an inverted fascist wants to destroy society almost completely. You know, abolish all the immigration controls, oppress the indigenous people. Fascism is completely antithetical to libertarianism because it is a fairly totalitarian system. But inverted fascism is worse because it would harm far more people. It would do far more damage, including really destroying the country. Now, there's no book on fascist methods and values. You sort of gleaned them from what is said. There's no book on woke methods and values. But if you look at them and say, well, if we're going to be consistent about what woke people believe, then they're going to push it this. And there's evidence, of course, that, you know, there is woke pressure put, you know, by the government onto the corporations to achieve certain woke ends as regards what can be said, who can be employed, and so forth. But in addition to this inversion of fascist values that the woke have, and the fact that it's going to be far worse than fascism, I mean, it wouldn't be nice to live in a fascist state, but it would be, living in an inverted fascist state would be somewhat like living in an Islamic state. It would, you couldn't, if you have any value for liberty, be comfortable in such a country. But in addition to this, what we have with wokesters that we don't have with fascists is a complete hypocrisy, because everything that they say they're trying to achieve officially is actually the opposite of what they're really trying to achieve. So they say, you know, they want equality, anti-racism, and so forth. But when you look at what they actually want in terms of legislation, they are in effect privileging all of the opposite groups. An example of this might be, maybe in a libertarian framework, is the fact that now, when you look at advertisements on television, even though blacks are 3% of the population, they seem to be about 30% of the actors in advertisements. And not only in advertisements, but also in programs that are made. And even historical programs. There's a black Queen Elizabeth or something. You think, what is going on here? They're privileging their preferred groups whilst claiming, no, we're only in favor of equality for all. That's nothing more. Now, Mark Brady said to me, you seem to be saying that wokeism is just political correctness on steroids? And I said, yeah, that's what I think it is. He thinks it's something completely different, that political correctness is all right, up to a point, but not this. Well, I mean, political correctness up to a point, insofar as you're just being polite to people, they prefer to be addressed in a certain way. Yeah, I'm in favour of that. But I don't think it should be the law. And if you don't address people in the way that they choose to be addressed, they have a right to call a policeman and say you've misgendered them or whatever. Now, I think that's about the size of it in enough words to start the conversation.
Well, if I might just like chip in with my interest in this. I'd ask the question straight away of why do we imagine that human beings are susceptible to this? So I would take it back to my usual default position, which is essentially it comes from psychological projections where people's understanding of self is relatively unsophisticated, simple. They construct an identity which is, in a sense, the sum total or the summation of all things that they happen to believe or accept about the world or their ethics. Then they impute to everything which is not that alien characteristics as a way of reinforcing their sense of self. They project it out into the world and everything that is not me is a problem because I need to reinforce who the me is. And I think that what groups do, group identities, sociologically and so on and so forth, enable people to attach to that projection of all that is not me so that people can say, well, this is who I am. And I don't really believe that that answers the question of who I am. And in terms of opportunity costs and the time that people have, if you see people as a very deep well, each person is unique and should be celebrated for who they are, it would take a considerable amount of time for an individual to get to know every individual on a unique basis that discreetly respected their idiosyncrasies and foibles. Instead, it's much easier to make them part of a group that wears a uniform, goes to a church, lump them off. They're a socialist. He's a Tory, and then we can navigate in a much more unperturbed sense our own particular ocean, and particularly in a problematic world post-COVID where everything has been destabilised and people are looking for stability. They'll go into fundamentalist religions, they'll get into any ideology which gives them a measure of certainty. Now, I ask those questions because I'm interested in the entry point, what baits the hook and why are people so responsive to it? I appreciate... that does not address the question as to whether this is centralised planning, whether it's deliberate, whether we just fell into it over time. But that would be my opening shot. You know, why are people susceptible to it?
Well, if I could reply to that.
Yeah.
First. In the article, I do discuss how people come to be woke, as far as I can see. Now, the fundamental argument is... there's a sort of ethical confusion. In the past, the state has enforced racism, sexism, homophobia, whatever you want to call it, and so forth. In order to rectify this, a lot of people have said, right, instead of the state enforcing these things, the state should enforce their opposites. Compulsory racial integration, compulsory employment of women, and homosexual, and so forth. Now, I think this is just an intellectual error. It out of the frying pan, into the fire. What the state should have stopped doing is, it should have stopped doing these illiberal things, but not started doing their illiberal opposites. So they had a moral motivation, but they became psychologically, there's a philosophical confusion in thinking that if you're not having this, you're having the opposite rather than having nothing. Mm-hmm. The state should just say nothing and then let people interact freely. But in addition to this intellectual error, as I see it, there are also various attractions, which is just to be holding fashionable views, views that you can use. So you've got something to say, you can virtue signal, You can feel good about yourself. You've given yourself an immoral identity that you approve of. And there are all these things there, but no very great deep thought, because you can simply follow the latest trend. And one example I give is not that this is the latest trend anymore. You must say people of color. You must never say colored people. But as I point out, there is no grammatical difference. That's like saying you must always say trousers of corduroy, never corduroy trousers, or you're a fabricist. It doesn't make any sense. So they keep coming up with these things to wrong foot people, and that's in there. Of course, there is some hypocrisy. It shows that their motives are not entirely as moral as they might appear. There's an awful lot of they want to shock the bourgeoisie, or maybe their parents and so forth. These are other motives they might have as well. But the fundamental mistake is simply that to think that if you have something wrong, what you want is the opposite of that thing rather than nothing. And everything else then just builds on that fundamental error.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And if you can show them that freedom of association and freedom of speech is far better than enforced association and enforced speech, then they can come round to a more libertarian position. I say that, but when I look at many people who call themselves libertarians, I often find them at least politically correct when they think they're not. And you find that they are saying politically correct things like, well, of course, racial discrimination is terrible. Listen, if you are, Nigerian background, and you only want to employ Nigerians in your company because you get on with them and you understand them and you want to do them a good turn, so you racially discriminate, I can't see anything wrong with that. And similarly, on every other basis, of course, if you run a big business, you're probably not going to want to discriminate against people. You are going to want to take the best people because that's how you make your best profits. But a certain amount of discrimination will be economical depending on the circumstances. And it's not necessarily a problem. It should be allowed.
Why do you think, Jan, that the people have been stupid enough en masse to give the government a mandate? Because obviously there was a point at which this was nascent. It emanated in certain places within the culture, within society. We probably can't identify exactly where it began. It probably wasn't implemented initially through a government policy document, but it crept in. So why would you, because I'm interested in this question of how did it gain traction? Because obviously the government are continuing to give it traction through legislation now, but why were the people en masse prepared to accept this kind of nonsense?
Well, I think once you make a mistake, there is a natural tendency to overcorrect. I cooked my porridge for 10 minutes and I burnt it. I'll try cooking it for a minute and see if that's enough. Overcorrection, it's a natural thing to do. I've gone far too far this way. Let's go equally the opposite direction. And it's simply that. But once you've got there, you've then got a lot of people with vested interests in staying there. And putting a lot of pressure on people, saying, no, we must employ enough people who are gay, trans, whatever. The economics of it is based on a mistake. But if you're in a position of being a politician, there's a very limited extent to which you can point this out and still keep your job.
Could I finally just add, Jan, can I just add though, because, for example, do you think there's anything to do with, say, popular cultural narratives which are reductionist, like, for example, Hitler is bad because everybody learnt in school a particular a version of history that it effectively moralises everything, polarises into a black and white, because it seems to me a lot of people would have issues around immigration, and they might, in the nuts and bolts of them, even through ignorance, resist any incursions of immigration and any popular attempt to propagandise and say, yes, we must correct some of the atrocities against the Hindus, or, you know, the migration from Africa of Ugandans in the 1970s. Most people wouldn't necessarily be seeing that as a corrective, but something like Hitler is bad, I can see that people attach very quickly to those simplistic little memes.
Ordinary people are not woke. Ordinary people are not even particularly politically correct. They might be prepared to be polite. This is a phenomenon among the chattering classes. That's where the real problem is. And in particular, in the universities, where I think this is, you know, come from, and it's universities are, because the state monopolizes the university and degree system, can't be a university. You cannot award a degree unless you have a royal charter, the government decides, and also funds them. You tend to attract people who are living off taxation, because if you're working in a university, you're a tax parasite. You don't really pay any tax. If they abolish the university, the amount of revenue the government would have would go up. They pretend to pay you a certain amount. They pretend to tax you. Really, they could have just said, paid you less in the first place, which you can't do if somebody's really paying tax. So we've got a parasitic class of intellectuals. Those intellectuals then have a vested interest in the continuation of this process and pushing for more of the same. And the only way that it can ultimately be stopped is by getting the state out of tertiary education, obviously also secondary and primary, but the intellectual problem here is a tertiary level, not so much in the STEM subjects, of course, but in all of the social sciences and in all of the arts, the lecturers are often as woke or more woke than their students.
Yes. Yeah, so, I agree with your original analysis that it's opposites in terms of an ideology, that wokeism is the opposite of fascism, and that the methods, though, are the same. Propaganda, dictatorship, corporations, etc. Suggest maybe an alternative term might be woke or dictatorship, perhaps, rather than, because obviously it's not fascism in an ideological sense. So that's just an observation there.
Can I take one point at a time, or do you want to do all of them?
No, we'll do it that way. I'm like you, I can only remember one question at a time. So yeah, okay. Count to that, and then I'll come with the rest.
As I said, if you're not going to say it's a form of fascism, then you have to say, well, an inverted snob isn't a kind of snob. But an inverted snob is a kind of snob.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah. But I'm just saying it's a form of dictatorship.
Therefore, I would say an inverted fascist is a kind of fascist in the same way. But at the same time, I would always want to say, of course, I'm not talking about Nazism, because a friend said to me, oh, you've gone full Nazi. I said, no, I'm not talking about Nazism. I'm not talking about Hitler. I am talking about fascism, the state and the corporations controlling the country in a totalitarian way.
Yes.
As Mussolini said in one famous speech, nothing against the state, everything in the state, nothing outside the state. That's the totalitarian fascist conception. Nazism is something completely separate. So I'm definitely not talking about Hitler. or anything to do with Marxism, even though obviously that is also a totalitarian and very nasty regime.
Most people wouldn't know the difference really between them. No. Go on, carry on.
In fact, I heard somebody on the radio today talking about fascism, and he clearly was conflating fascism and Nazism. Mm. And, you know, that's not useful. And I can see why. Now, it might be said, well, I just want to say something nasty about woke people. And yes, I do.
Yeah. Well, that's
because, they don't want to have freedom of association, and they don't want to have freedom of speech. And I think that's terrible. And but I said, even if we don't have the label, they're still as bad. They're still worse than fascists. Even if we don't say, okay, you're not kind of fascist, but you're worse, objectively worse, because you would destroy society if you pushed these things far enough. Now, that isn't to say all woke people are equally woke. Not all of them have pushed every aspect as far, this far. It's what these things logically imply if you take them and keep on pushing them to their logical extreme, then this is what you seem to have. So whilst many people may only be just a bit woke, or not even woke, they're just a bit PC. So I'm not saying everybody is at this extreme, but just that at the extreme, full on wokeism is inverted fascism. Okay, next question.
Okay, well, it follows on from your last part of the answer there. So the business of wokeism being worse than fascism, a bigger threat to Western civilization. So I've got the other, you said, like, it destroys everything. Does it build anything? At least fascism, you might disagree with it, but it claimed, and Nazism claimed, that they were building. They thought they were the wave of the future, didn't they, back in the 30s and so forth. Wokeism does seem to be more just destructive and nothing.
An example of that is when there was a woke cry to get rid of the police. Now, had they been saying privatize the police, yes, fine, but they just wanted to get rid of the police. Yeah. And partly that happened in America. The police stood back and let the looters get on with it. It's partly happened in this country now, that if people will go shoplifting and the police, I think there's some who have said, well, if they haven't stolen something worth at least £300, don't call us. Well, we won't arrest them. We haven't got enough men. And so the police are not doing their jobs. Even when we've got the person who did it, we can prove he did it. We've got him on camera committing the act of theft. Mm. The police haven't got time to come and arrest him.
They don't seem to have offered a vision of an alternative society or whatever. So that leaves me on to the next bit, which Alex was saying. He was asking why wokeism has seemed to be attracting, and why now might be a kind of variant on that as well. And the answer that you gave, and I agree with, is that it's the ideology of the sort of power elites, mostly, but it does seem to have penetrated down. I don't know where it come from. It come from PCism originally, didn't it? Which I think
the 80s of political correctness. It's taking it to a new level.
And it's just kind of seeped into the various, you know, parts of society. But it has created an opposition, though, hasn't it, of national populism amongst the ordinary people. There's a lot of resentment. They're not organised as well as the power elite, but I think there's a lot of resentment amongst ordinary people, and an opportunity there, which has occurred a bit with things like Trump and Brexit and Orban and so on, different countries. So there's a kind of, well, they call it the culture wars, don't they? So there is another side to it, to defending the traditional culture in opposition. Again, it is in opposition, one identity against another. Mm. You're right there. So I just wonder where we think it's going, how much of a threat.
Well, there's a fight back by lots of, you know, there are intellectuals, often not in the universities, but outside, writing books criticising wokeness in its various forms. explicitly saying, you know, what's wrong with woke, and in going into it in book length. But it's interesting that a lot of this fight back has to be outside the universities. It can't be in the universities, because the universities have become more and more caught up in them.
Yeah.
And I just can't see any way out of it but simply to say, of universities at least, we don't need to provide universities. You can, you know, the prices would fall like a stone if anybody can start awarding degrees, and universities can compete with each other. It wouldn't be the destruction of the top universities by any means. They still got a lot of prestige, and they'd keep that prestige up, and they'd keep their income up. They just, you've taken away that tax bribe. And then once people find themselves in the market, they are more inclined to please their customers, and their customers are going to be ordinary people who do not want to be lectured at and harangued for their white privilege and so forth. At the moment, if you go to university, that's going to happen. You can't go to a university easily where that won't happen. You're going to go, if you if you go to one of these universities, you're likely to come out more woke than when you went in, but you're likely to start out as a bit woke just because it's filtered down to the schools now.
We've got 5 minutes.
Just
so you know, that's
So I'm kind of agreeing with most, except for the privatization business, of course. But
Agree with the problem, but not the solution, right?
Well, I agree that society's got lots of problems, and I don't like walkers any more than you do. It's a Western phenomenon. It appears to be a Western.
Go and try and be woke in Saudi Arabia.
Right, exactly.
See how long you last,
Okay, so you kind of anticipated my question. Do you think it'll spread to the non-West? Because, of course, they're becoming more important. There's more than one non-West, of course, but it doesn't appear to have gone so far, but who knows?
Well, I hope it's going to be turned back in the West.
Yes.
I hope that, programs like this that explain what's wrong with it, people will watch them and say, I'd rather be free to say what I want, do what I want with consenting adults within the confines of their property and not have anybody dictate to me. You can't say that, you know, you must employ this person. If people just come round to the idea of a voluntarist society, it's another word for libertarian.
Yes.
If enough people come round, the politicians will have to follow them. Because you've got to buy your votes by promising the people what they want. And if what they want is something in the same way that they said, we want Brexit instead of all this European position. You know, but the danger is that politicians are going to try to avoid anything like a democratic system like the plague, because it takes the power away from them. We don't live in a democracy. We live in an elected oligarchy. Yes. The elected oligarchs like their power. They gave us a little bit of democracy on the day that they allowed us to vote for Brexit. And they only did it because they thought there was no danger that there really would be a Brexit. And they put all of their spin and lying propaganda against Brexit. And they didn't. They are not going to want to let that happen again.
They only respond when their power is threatened and when their money is threatened. That's when the power elite, you know, starts to move. Wokeism, so maybe it's got its own destruction within it as well. It goes too far, it alienates and I mean, you mentioned the police in America, and then they've trolled back on that now because they've abolished the police in whatever these woke cities, Portland, or wherever it was.
Yes,
and then the crime goes up, and some people think suddenly realise, oh, actually, that was a bit daft.
The danger, real danger from the woke people's point of view is that people react so strongly against their inverted fascism, is that they say, well, we'd rather have a fascist regime.
Proper fascism.
Because they're going too far in the overcorrection of wokeness. I said, you don't want them. You don't want either of them. You just want individual liberty and freedom of association. But so there's a real danger that you'll get an overreaction to them.
Yes, and this seesaw effect will occur almost inevitably because we're in a context of nation states. Everyone looks to the state as providing a solution.
Yeah, and I don't know, we're getting very close, but I just wanted to say that in terms of the whole gamut of everything we've spoken about, it seems to me right from the outset when you started speaking, heart of the matter seems to be that systematic thinkers don't have the luxury of being lazy, whereas the vast majority of people in our society err towards leading some kind of life that's not really reflective, systematic, because of opportunity cost and time. And that's the real battle that we're fighting here, to show people the imperative of systematic thinking and taking it seriously and applying it in their own life.
Final word, John.
This is why in the article I quoted Bertrand Russell on this. He says most people would rather die than think. In fact, they do. It wokeism is a lazy ideology, and we're asking people to think a bit hard about things that they don't think about when they're very comfortable with it, and it's very fashionable.